In the previous video, we looked at the viewer in more detail, focusing on its cameras and navigation controls. In this video, we'll show how you can control which objects are displayed in the viewer, how they're displayed, and how to customize the elements that are displayed in the viewer window itself. Let's start off by deciding which objects are displayed in our scene using the options in the appropriately named Display menu. By default, the Normal option is on, which means that you can display whatever is selected in the model's visibility menu, such as nulls, markers, which includes control rig elements, skeletons, lights, cameras, and models. You can also select Models Only, which displays only objects that have 3D geometry, such as Natasha's body mesh, the pillars, or this tree. If you want to see your character's control rig on top of the body mesh, select X-ray. This mode makes it much easier to select the control rig parts in the viewer when you're animating your character. Note that you can still select the body mesh, but we'll show you another way to control that later in this video. The easiest way to change what's displayed is to make sure the cursor is over the view, then press Ctrl plus A to toggle among Normal, Modes Only, and X-ray. A nice little tool that MotionBuilder has in the viewer is the Ruler tool, which lets you measure distances between objects in your scene. Click the little arrow beside the ruler icon and choose Preferences to set up the ruler's unit of measurement and appearance. To get rid of the ruler, choose Delete Ruler from the same menu. Another useful tool that sits beside the ruler is the Trajectories tool. Select an animated object, then click this button to show the object's motion path. Each dot in the trajectory curve represents a frame on the timeline. You can't select or manipulate these curves to change the animation, but they can show you many things about your animation, such as the velocity of the animation, which you can see by the distance between each of the dots on the curve, or how smooth the animation is. Click the Trajectories button again to deactivate it. Now let's look at how you can change the appearance of the models or geometric objects in your scene. You can choose from the different shading options in the Models Display menu here, but it's much faster to use their keyboard shortcuts. Press 1 for Wireframe, which shows only the geometry lines of the objects. Press 2 for Flat, which considers the object's surface to be flat, ignoring any lights in the scene or the object's textures and shader settings. Press 3 for Lighted, which shows the effects of any lights in the scene on the objects, but without their textures. Press 4 for Textures, which shows the 2D textures associated with each material. Press 5 for Shaders, which shows the base material of the object, which is essentially its color and shading model. And press 6 for Textures plus Shaders, which shows the textures on top of the base material of the objects. If we switch to multiple views, you can see that these shading options apply to the entire scene, not just the active view. If the shading on any of your objects is looking strange, you can check that its normals are pointing in the correct direction by activating Display Normals in the Display menu. Because these objects look furry, it means that their normals are pointing outwards, which is what we want. If there is an object whose normals are pointing the wrong way, select it and choose Invert Normals. Turn off the normals display when you're done. You've seen how you can choose the types of objects to display or hide in your scene, but sometimes you just need to hide a couple of random objects. To do this, select one or more objects and choose Display Hide Selected or press Shift plus H. To redisplay hidden objects, select them in the navigator, then choose Show Selected or press Shift plus S. You can also hide everything in the scene except for the selected objects with the Hide Unselected command. We'll just press Ctrl plus Z to undo that, because when you choose the Show Unselected command, everything in your scene that's not selected will be displayed, which we don't really want. The same thing happens if you choose Show Selected with nothing selected in the scene. When you have a lot of objects in your scene, or just certain ones that you want to keep hidden, hiding and redisplaying objects this way may not be the way to go. A better way to control the visibility objects is to put them in a group, such as all the pillars, all the trees, or a character's body geometry. Select the objects and click the Groups tab in the Resources window. Click the Create button and give the new group a name, such as Body Geo. Now you can toggle the visibility of these objects, as well as their selectability and transformability. For example, turning off the Groups Pick option is useful so that you can't select the model when selecting parts of the control rig. A different way of hiding parts of the scene is to set the camera's near and far planes. These planes determine what is displayed in the viewer and subsequently what will be rendered. We'll switch to a custom camera that we created to be able to see the planes, since you can't display them for the producer cameras. The plane options are set in the camera's properties, which you can open in the navigator. To make it easier to set the planes, we can first display them with the camera near far planes option in the view area. Then split the viewer so that we can see our camera using another camera's viewpoint. If you don't see the camera, make sure to open the Display Models Visibility menu and select Cameras. You can drag in the near and far planes text boxes or enter a value to set these for your scene. While we're in the camera's properties, let's take a quick look at how you can customize the elements that are shown for each camera in the viewer. You can set the camera's background color using the sliders or the color editor. You can select the object you want to use as the camera interest, then display it. Note that you can display the interest only for custom cameras, not producer cameras, since they don't have a true camera interest. You can display the camera label, which shows not only the name of the camera and its display mode, but also the name of the selected object and the current transform tool. You can display the global axis, which is just a visual reference that helps keep you oriented. Display the center of the scene or origin, which is also a visual reference to keep you oriented. And display the grid. While you can display or hide the grid from here, you need to set up how it looks from the viewer options in the Preferences editor. This includes the default grid color, offset from the scene center, the size, and the spacing. You can also display the time code, which shows the current frame in the timeline, often useful if you're doing a test render of your animation. And finally, you can display the camera's safe area. This shows the boundaries within which titles or action in the scene should be placed when rendering out. The red line shows the cutoff limits for the action in the scene, and the yellow line shows the cutoff limits for titles. You can toggle the timecode and safe area options for all views from the Display Head-Up Display menu. The HUD options allow you to show a few other display elements in the viewer. But if you want a custom HUD, drag in a HUD asset from the Templates Elements folder in the Asset Browser and set it up as you like. So that wraps up our look at many of the viewer's features. In the next video, we'll cover the different ways of selecting and transforming objects.